Thank you all for coming. Just a few quick sort of logistical announcements. The restrooms, the key logistical announcement, are right here and to either side, so men's, women's. We are going to have all of our breaks and refreshments upstairs in Thomas Great Hall. If any of you guys have been to that camp or sort of the, any sort of conference that uses the unconference idea like that camp does, I've done a little bit of that. I'm asking you guys if you want to, we have, as you can see, 10 tables. So if you guys want to talk about a particular topic, if you're looking for someone to collaborate with on X, right, there's an easel upstairs with a pad that says lunchtime table topics. Write down what it is you want to form a cluster about, and my conference assistants, Yichen and Angela, will make table tents. So we'll assign a table to each topic, okay? And if you guys don't do stuff, we're going to make some for you. If you want to talk about what you want to talk about, be sure to put something up there. Another quick note, we're going to be recording these sessions because I know there are always people who can't make them, and they'll be posted up on the conference website along with any slides and whatnot. And I think that's it. So I'll introduce the first speakers, which are myself and Kim Cassidy, our provost, soon to be interim president.
Another talk.
We'll get started.
So we're going to provide a bit of an overview of the NGLC project, because some of you are sort of new to this. Some of you have heard this before, and we'll try to go through the overview quickly so we can get to some of the data that we've been collecting here at Bryn Mawr and at some of our partner institutions on the effectiveness of blended learning in the LAC environment. And then hopefully have time at the end to talk about sort of next steps. So why did we pick blended learning to sort of focus some work around the use of technology in education? The idea actually came from discussions about blended learning at a conference of provosts and actually CFOs that got together. The Northeast Deans is a group of provosts that get together once a year and are sort of liberal arts colleges in the Northeast. And the CFOs actually chose the readings for this conference, and they chose some articles on blended learning. And they were fascinated by it because of the efficiencies that they saw. And the provosts were excited about it because of the possibility of the effectiveness. So the data that we had to look at showed that these blended courses had a lot of benefits to them that seemed very promising. But the issue was that all of these studies were done at large universities. And so we were wanting to know whether they're going to offer the same or equivalent benefits in our environment where the learning environment is different from the start. So in other words, one of the things that students really like is in typical blended models, there's a reduction in seat time because you substitute online learning for class time. And so students were happier because they were spending less time in class.
And they were commuting students, so this, as you can imagine, would matter a lot more.
Right. And then, the comparison groups were often these, the control course was a course with hundreds of people in it, right? So, that kind of getting that targeted individualized learning you get in a blended environment is going to feel really differently when you're comparing that to a, several hundred person class. And then we had some serious questions about whether or not blended learning was really, fits with the culture and the values of institutions like ours that really prize that student-faculty close interaction. So what we really wanted to do was, with the grant, was to encourage and support faculty who are interested in experimenting with blended learning in the context of the liberal arts environment. We actually had goals that were very modest. So we actually had hoped that four faculty of Bryn Mawr would take it up. And in fact, we had 14 who piloted it in some form or another. And we were hoping that 10 faculty at other institutions would give it a try. And we had 40. At more than 25 of our partners. So, and then we were wanting to look at these experiments to see how did faculty experience it, how did students experience, and could we do any kind of quantitative assessment to see whether it actually helped with learning. So we also adopted a definition of blended learning that actually didn't make the CFOs happy, but we thought fit with our culture and values. And I think that actually made a huge difference to the ease with which people kind of took to the idea. So we defined the blended as being where the students receive feedback on their learning outside of class through these computer-based materials. So not just lecture capture. So not just sort of saying, well, we're going to put, content without any interaction on the internet and have students watch it. We wanted to have a component of this was about students getting feedback. And that this kind of feedback and what the students were doing outside of class alters or informs what faculty are doing within the classroom. But we did not have it substitute for seat time. So this did not replace what we think is the really valuable thing which we do with our students in our classrooms. So there was no requirement to use seat time, and I don't think we had anybody who actually did. We really tried to have this be driven by the pedagogical goals of the faculty. So this really wasn't about the technology. This was about faculty wanting to accomplish certain things in their classrooms, and that's how we built everything. So we didn't say you must use these tools in this way for this much time, but we started with Jennifer saying, what do you want to do? How do you think you want to do it? And then kind of built from there. So again, this notion of the pedagogy driving the technology as opposed to technology for technology's sake. We had originally targeted the grant for intro STEM courses, and as you can see across both Bryn Mawr and then our partner institutions, there has been a much wider uptake While we had focused on one particular thing, in large part because we thought that's what the funder would be most interested in, we certainly opened it up on our campus, as did folks on other campuses. And then quickly, just to give you an overview of the funding, and then Jennifer will give you more specifics. We always want to, as an experimental psychologist, these data make me a little nervous. They're not highly controlled, well-done experiments. So I'm always like, oh my God, I've spent 20-some years teaching my students, kind of how to, interpret data, and then I just, break all the rules. But we have some data that suggests that blended learning may improve learning outcomes for students in our kinds of environments. That our students and faculty find it useful and consistent with our values, again, because it supports student learning. And what seems to be really key to its success are flipping the question, so it's about pedagogy, and also focusing on mitigating the startup costs. The biggest obstacle, Jennifer and I get called all the time to talk to people who are thinking about blended learning. Everyone's really worried about faculty attitude. So they say, weren't your faculty resistant? Didn't they not want to do this? Isn't this against, kind of what faculty want to do? And that was not our experience at all. It doesn't seem to be true at our partner institutions. The biggest issue seems to be around the costs in terms of time and materials, in terms of getting, being able to do this. So we're not, the resistance isn't about the use of technology in this way. It's about, do I have the time to do this? Will whatever I do this year be useful next year because you'll switch our learning metrics to next year? And is it the case that, we're going to, that this is going to be something that, I'm going to get my time's worth out of to be able to use in the future?
So I'm going to just briefly go over some of the suggestive data, as Kim was talking about. One of the things we looked at, and this was in part because, again, you asked the questions that, in our case, we put in our proposal to the funders, but one of the things that they're very interested in is students completing college. So we looked at the merit completion rates for these courses, and by that I mean completing with a merit grade, so above 2.0 or higher, which you would need to have this count towards your degree in a particular subject, for your major. So for all of the pilot courses at Bryn Mawr in our study, this was around 85%, which is quite good. It was 93.5% in the gateway STEM courses, so science, technology, math, anything that fell into that category. And we singled that out in part again because when we were proposing this, we were
earmarking this as a particular target. And the average for these courses at Bryn Mawr historically, for the non-blended ones, that is, has been 83%. So we really wanted to push that up to about 90%, and we went above even that. So again, that's something, but how does that compare to other courses, things over time, this sort of thing? So we did look at historical norms. There were only a few courses in which we could do this, and part of the issue is, in some cases, courses have changed for other reasons over time, right? In some cases, this was the first and maybe the only time a course would be offered, but there were four courses that we could compare: Biology 101, Chemistry 101, which is sort of a preparatory half semester course for students going on to do general chemistry, which is Chemistry 103, and then Geology, which is the mineralogy crystal chemistry course that majors take. So all of these were introductory courses, all of them science courses. And in the blended version of three of these courses, the average grade was about one standard deviation higher than the average grades for non-blended versions, going back to, I think we looked back to 2000 and up. And then the merit completion rate, so the students completing with a 2.0 or higher, was again around 0.8 to 1.5 standard deviations higher. So what about that fourth course? This is always a 3 out of 4 dentists, right? Who's the fourth dentist? So this was Chemistry 103, general chemistry, and there were somewhat mixed results when you compared them to historical data. So the average grade was slightly higher, but the merit completion rate was quite a bit lower, for example. So one of the things in this class, and again, this varied from course to course, the particular online problem set, sort of homework system that they were using, which was called OWL, tracked how students were doing. So we were able to sort of look at the data from that, and it did it in this robust, easy sort of export way that is also always not always the case. So we were able to sort of compare how students were doing or what they were doing with their final grades. And we did find that the materials had a positive impact, or seemed to have a positive impact. There's a strong correlation between the percentage of the material that they completed and their final grade. And I should say that, because I get this question every time, this was set up, and in most classes I've noticed this is how instructors have done this. The online materials that they were doing were sort of a low stakes, you practice, you get some, homework credit maybe, but very, very tiny portion of the grade. The final grade for the course was based primarily on student performance on exams. Usually, I think in this case, it was a midterm and a final that were the two key grades. For undergraduates, we had their SAT math score. So this course serves both post-bacs and undergraduates, and it was about more undergraduates than post-bacs. I would say maybe two-thirds, one-third. So when you added in the completion rate, when you added in their SAT math score, if you look just at the SAT math score alone, that predicted about 30% of their final grade. When you added in the percent of the materials that they completed, that predicted 58%. And there was a correlation professor at Trinity College happened to teach same course, same materials, and saw an equally strong, or actually a stronger correlation. He has a much smaller class, so it's a little bit. So, what does this tell us? Students who do their homework consistently. Yes, I know. Revolutionary. And I really don't think you would see any difference if you took the time to track paper and pencil how students were doing in class. If they were using paper-based problem sets. But I think there are some differences, and this is sort of the things that we want to explore moving further, how much these differences have an impact. One is that these kinds of patterns are more visible, and the instructors, in this case, can say to their students, hey, we have evidence that people that do their homework consistently do better, right? That it's much more important how you do over the course of this class than it is what your SAT scores or how good you are at science, right? Second, these online assessments are typically graded more quickly than paper-based ones, so students do know sooner what they're having difficulties with, and instructors can kind of get a picture of how students are doing in a way that might not be possible or might be much more difficult if you're using just paper-based assessments and exercises. And then I would say it seems like in some of these cases the amount of assessment increases, or in some cases it's there are optional problems that students can do, you know, that might not be the case, or they might be able to do them, but they wouldn't get any feedback on them if they did do them. So there's that. So perspectives for faculty. As we said, both faculty and students have responded very, very positively and have found this very consistent with liberal arts colleges for kind of surprising ways, maybe. All of the faculty in Bryn Mawr have continued to use a blended learning approach, not necessarily this exact same, right, with some tweaking. The majority of respondents at our partner colleges, and not everyone has gotten back to me, but, you know, intend to. And often faculty report using sort of techniques or tools that they've piloted in one course and another course. And at Bryn Mawr College, you can see sort of people outside of this starting to experiment with it as well, people that weren't part of the pilot. And I think the biggest, you know, when I ask people, so what is it? It's the formative assessment element. It's the ability to assess more often, more quickly. As I said, most faculty use this as a sort of low stakes practice, test, practice, quizzing, and it's this idea that it emphasizes mastery. Both faculty and students picked up on that. Take advantage of some of the sort of, and I'm going to talk about this in the next session, some of the learning science around testing effect, retrieval practice. And the, oh, so, sorry. This is a quiz. that one of our faculty members created for the mineralogy course, that Geology 202. And you can see she's got a picture of a mineral sample here, not a rock, mineral. and she has this, I learned. She has this question, name the mineral, right? Pretty straightforward. So typically in something like Geology 202, students would practice this in lab, but that would be the only chance they would get to practice. Okay, and they might have a paper-based lab sheet. You know, the old way was you did your lab sheet, you filled it out, and then 2 weeks later you got it back and said, no, actually that wasn't selenite. It didn't, you know, it doesn't mean anything to you. The more sophisticated version is you flip the paper over and it tells you what it is, right? But nonetheless, the practice was confined to the lab, okay? What she did was essentially for visual identification skills, allow people to practice outside of class. But this is the other thing that happened. I should also say, notice she asked them name the mineral, but then she also asked them what made you think it was this particular thing. So there's a little bit of metacognition involved here, and I'm going to talk about that in this next session. Okay, so this is what the instructor sees. This is what the students, so she first said serpentine, andalusite, kyanite, quartz, and cobalt. Okay, as it happened, there were 10 possible choices. So clearly, right, the student was guessing, okay? And this tells you something. And if the student is doing this on every single thing, that tells you something. Or if all students are doing this particular mineral, that tells you something. So what Selby did with data like this, and she didn't always go into the, you know, question by question, she sometimes looked at sort of the broad overview of how people were doing. But she used that then the next time they got back into class and said, hey, I've noticed people are having problems, you know, telling the difference between quartz and selenite. Let's look at that, right? Okay. So, and it's that sort of real-time picture of how students are doing that faculty, I think, have talked about this supporting sort of more agile teaching where they are just-in-time teaching is sometimes the terminology used, you know, where you can basically capitalize on that information in your next class and focus on the things people are having difficulty with. The other thing that both faculty and students picked up on is that this kind of data, which the instructor is getting and the student to some extent is getting, really led to more fruitful conversations with students. So when students would come into class, they would come in with very specific questions. You know, you had me until you got to this point, covalent bonds or whatever, you know, and this is where I'm having a problem. Could you go over that? Rather than, I just can't do all of this. This is just terrible, you know. Also in office hours, students would come in, they would have very specific questions, or they would come in, one of our faculty members, and for those of you who have heard this talk before, this is the anecdote we always pull out, but he noticed that he had two students come in to office hours right about the same time, and they both were saying, oh, I'm having so much difficulty, I'm working so hard, and I'm just not getting this, you know, I can't do chemistry, I can't do it. And he was able to look at the data on what the students were doing, and one student was indeed, you know, doing far more problems than all of the optional problems, you know, really spending a lot of time on these exercises, redoing them, and not getting it. And so that was, you know, kind of a problem, and he could work with her on how do we move forward from there. The other student was doing, like, you know, two standard deviations less work than everybody else, right, and less time. And so he was able to talk to me, okay, for what you did in high school, this might be what you think of as hard work, but here's what your peers are doing, you know, here's what the kind of time that people are having to put in, right? So that was a different kind of intervention. And he wouldn't really have known that if he hadn't had this kind of data. So I said the majority of people from partner colleges who have talked to me are going to do this. And again, as Kim said, you know, we always get called upon to talk about faculty attitudes. And I have found that when people decide not to continue with this, it's a cost-benefit analysis. It's that, you know, I will be teaching this course again for a long time or frequently, so it doesn't make sense for me to put as much effort required to get the materials, to get everything set up, right? Or the available materials don't work, and, you know, it's a big hurdle from taking something that's kind of there off the shelf and adapting it to creating something totally your own, right? So this is probably, for those of you in the room who are faculty, it's probably not surprising, but the idea that faculty are rational actors when they're rejecting and when they're adopting technology. It's news to some. Student feedback, also positive. This was a standard question we asked. Do you think the computer-based materials impacted or have impacted how well you did or doing in this class? Sometimes we use generic computer-based materials if there were multiple things being done in the class. Sometimes we things. The vast majority of students say it was either very helpful, which is the light blue, or somewhat helpful, which is the yellow. So you can see a much smaller percentage think they, you know, didn't help, didn't hurt, and so a very tiny percentage think that they had a negative impact or don't know. Oh, and the other lesson there is, so we did Bryn Mawr partner colleges, this is tracking the same. So we reported on partner colleges, this is the first time that we've had the data to compare, sorry, the way around. We reported on Bryn Mawr, this is the first time we've had data from partner colleges to compare. And you can see in terms of sort of what students think are helpful, it also tracks pretty similarly. You'll notice that instant feedback, chance to practice on additional problems are very high. Students are also very interested in the visual presentation of materials, animations, videos. They tend to find those very helpful. Summaries of information also helpful. Some of these, like virtual experiments, these aren't at all software, so. Also, students are using materials in pretty much similar ways. We found that this depends a lot on how the faculty has set up the materials and what the materials are sort of doing. So we actually added in to complete an assignment because in many cases these were sort of small, low stakes assignments. But one thing that was surprising to many people was that a lot of students were going back to these exercises. So many were, you know, designed as something to help the students get a concept right at that time, but they were actually going back and working through some of those problems again to get a sense. So again, students, the instant feedback from their perspective, it allows them to ask better questions in class. A big one for them, they can get help on something before the class moves on, so they know sooner what they don't know. They can structure their study time so they're focusing on the things they don't know. A lot of them, they really appreciated the idea of mastery, although they didn't use that terminology. They said things like, I like to be able to practice before it counts, right? So I get feedback on how I'm doing before I take the exam. That's the one that goes on my grade. Equally important, which was interesting, is I like to be able to stop working once I've got something, right? No busy work. College students do not like busy work. So that was equally important.
There's a question.
Yeah.
Can you go back two slides for a second?
Sure.
So on this slide, I guess I'm wondering, what would you say the faculty would say as to why they got involved in blended learning? Of those, you know, it seems to me like it's, you know, the purpose of involving these online materials, you know, anyway.
Right. Yeah. And as I said, this is sort of a lump report on what everybody said. This varied a lot by classes, depending on how the faculty was using it. I would say the majority of faculty were either trying to help students prepare in advance for something, so they had exercises, they wanted them to work through some of the concepts or maybe some of the skills, and then they would focus on those in class. Sometimes it was a flipped kind of thing where you work on the concepts and then we're going to do a lot of problem solving in class, the kind of stuff you might do at home. Or it was to provide students with something that they could go back to after the lecture to kind of, you know, figure out what they didn't know. If students maybe came in with different levels of preparation, I think one of the reasons you see faculty being most interested in using this in introductory courses, it's not just that those are typically the larger courses and things like that, but it's that you know less about those students, right? And they kind of come in with different levels of prep. They may have had a really strong biology program in one school and not so much in another. So I would say it was pretty much those two things that faculty were targeting. And they set them up as assignments for that purpose, but that was kind of in the back of their minds. So I mentioned audiovisual. This keeps coming up really frequently in student feedback, that they really, really appreciate the animations, simulations. Here's an example of, this actually was a kind of clunky one, but nonetheless, you could go through sort of a lab procedure before you actually had to do it. Here you actually see what the lab procedure should look like, right? Ideally, and this is what you should get kind of thing. When students say they like audiovisual, they mean animations, illustrations of things, of concepts, of procedures, of processes. They don't necessarily mean they want to see you talking. and they don't necessarily want really long things, right? We have started experimenting a little bit with lecture capture, and a lot of times students are really using that to go back and review. I didn't get that quite in my notes. You know, they're not watching start to finish. And they didn't necessarily want this in lieu of doing something like this in the class. It's just that with their videos, they can go back and pause it, they can take notes, right, in a way that they can't necessarily do in class. So they like to have both of those things. So just to sort of sum up what we learned about, you know, why we think this was relatively successful. One, the pedagogy must drive technology. And you know, to keep in mind that adoption is a rational cost-benefit analysis. The big barrier is the startup cost. It takes a lot of time to find out information, to figure out how to use these things. In some cases, the second barrier is lack of suitable materials. So publishers are focusing on particular courses, usually introductory courses, usually courses that are, you know, a broad number of students are taking. Sometimes those work in our case, sometimes they don't. They don't cover all classes we want to teach. And then also we try to, when I help faculty find materials and when I think about different types of things we might want to bring in, look at being able to capitalize that investment, right? Use that over time so that you're not having to every year adopt something completely new. So you have to keep making that investment. So where do we go next?
want to click.
Yes, awesome. So I think one of the things that we've learned is just how effective this consortium has been. I mean, we participate in a lot of different ways and various partnerships, and it has seemed to us for not a huge amount of investment and time that people have really been able to learn from each other and make effective connections. And so I think we're very invested in trying to keep this partnership going, you know, ideally with funding, but also, but even, you know, we don't need much because it seems like the partnerships that need to be made are being made. And so, you know, one way obviously is, you know, this conference and being able to, you know, kind of be together and share with one another, particularly, you know, with folks from our sector who are using things that we might also use in our classroom. So I think why this has been effective is because we share many, many things in common. And so it makes it easy for something that someone's doing at one institution to transfer to someone else, even if the particular things don't transfer, the ideas transfer really nicely. So one is to bring together folks to a conference.
And we've just, the reason I'm mousing over here is, so this is the schedule from last year's events. Wherever we have videos, slides, things like this, these materials are archived on the conference itself. So you guys can always go back and get them, pass them on. We have moved to this platform because it is more discoverable, so it's easier to find these things if you're just doing a Google search as well.
And then Jennifer's been doing some webinars.
Yes, and one of the things that I discovered when I was trying to get vendors to come and talk to us about different tools is that they're actually, their sales force is scattered all over the world, and it's easier for them to do webinars. So some of these things I'd like to start doing, maybe a monthly webinar where different person talks about a tool that's being used in some of our classes. And I'm taking ideas if you guys have something you want to hear about, learn about. One thing I found just in doing this is that the industry right now is changing. Like, you know, I contact someone in the next, you know, month or something, they're no longer there, they've moved into a different division, or someone has bought that company. So it really is, you know, an ongoing struggle to kind of keep on top of this. So I'm thinking this might help us.
And then we're also trying to collect what people are doing and make it available to our partners, so that if somebody else is teaching a course in psych stats and has developed materials or has played with the OLI materials and made them more adaptable in some way, can we make that available to others in the consortium and beyond? And so we've been working on a new collaborative website that collects all of these materials and makes them more findable for folks in our institutions.
So we were using Google, which was useful for people in the TRIBCO, but it's a little hard for our partners outside of that to get in and to post information. This site, and it's sort of just going live right now, it's got resources, and you can see you know, reviews of different resources, how people are using them. But the great part is that you guys can also, I don't see the little link for it, but there's a link that says, join the group, here we go. You can email me and you can actually become someone who's posting. So if you've used something and want to warn everybody else, do not use this resource, it is terrible, right? You can post here. So then it's not just me having to collect information and post, but this makes it a lot easier for people outside of it to share as well. And all of these things have comments, so you can talk about different things. People on the site in the group will have a profile, and so you can sort of see who's doing different things with different resources as well.
So that's one area, just to continue the collaboration, the consortium development. Another is that we're beginning to hear over and over again from folks that there are particular areas where many different institutions are, you know, we're teaching the same courses, we're providing the same experiences. Like, many of us provide research opportunities, senior thesis, or other forms of research experiences for our students, and we teach the same things over and over and over again, you know. So, you know, and but there aren't a tremendously great, they're not the best materials or materials that are suited for the particular kinds of research that we do with our students on our campuses, that one-on-one closely mentored research. So would that be an area where we would, through the consortium, want to develop a set of materials and get a few faculty together who teach these courses and who are really interested to develop our own materials, maybe in a little bit more sophisticated manner, a little bit more supported manner, so that we could then have something that would be able to be useful across a wide number of institutions and reach a lot of students and a lot of partner institutions. So we're beginning to explore what those courses might be and how we might be able to get support to be able to do that. And then obviously, I think we would love to be able to continue to coordinate our research on the impact of these techniques and to be able to collect data and then share it back in terms of what we're learning, both about whether it is effective, but under what conditions. Are there certain practices around using blended techniques that are really effective and maybe others not so much? So to be able to share that with each other.
And I'm more than happy to talk to anyone. I mean, I've kind of been doing the coordinating for what we've done so far. So if anyone wants to talk to me about the instruments we're using or things like that, I'm more than happy to do that.
So that's it.
Yes, we have time for questions. Okay, yes.
Could you talk about the distribution of the 40 classes outside of Bryn Mawr vis-a-vis the classes at Bryn Mawr?
What do you mean exactly?
By
subject,
discipline,
by,
yes.
By discipline, yes. I would say that at Bryn Mawr, we were focused primarily on the sciences because that was the initial thing. So our courses were in chemistry, biochemistry, computer science, economics, geosciences, geology specifically, math, psych, but the psych that was sort of the research prep, so a lot of statistics and math. I think faculty, later faculty who adopted at Bryn Mawr have been going into anthropology, art history, some other areas, so it's kind of broadened beyond that now.
And languages,
yes. And then the other colleges kind of pushed it into these other areas. So, and one thing to say too is on our website, we have links to all of these syllabi, descriptions of all the courses where faculty have given us syllabi. We have links to those, links to any of the resources that they were using as well. Mm-hmm. So feel free to look. Links to the faculty emails and bombard them.
And this one thing I wasn't clear on. The sort of online learning tools, objects, whatever, are you making them in-house? Are they made here? Are you getting them from publishers? Like, for example, we saw that one with the poor woman struggled through finally on number 10, getting the right mineral.
Right.
Was that something that someone here created, or did you get that through a publisher in combination with a textbook?
Yeah, great question. So I would say all of the above. So the mandate for this particular grant from the foundation was to use materials that are available wherever possible, and certainly that makes the most sense, I think. So, for example, we used OWL, which is was developed by University of Massachusetts at Amherst, I think, but it has become a commercial product that is connected to textbooks that you buy through Cengage. So we used that. We tried using OLI materials wherever possible. This is the Open Learning Initiative out of Carnegie Mellon. They develop similar types of materials, but they're independent of a textbook, and they're either free or low cost to your students. So we use that in our statistics psychology course as well. In some cases, though, materials were not available. So, for example, in the computer science class, the particular one on this campus was a linguistics computer science, pretty high level course, and so he had to make his own materials. Selby made those quizzes that you saw, Moodle, the one where the student did all the guessing, because there wasn't really any good mineralogy tools. There's some practice stuff out there, but you can't really track what students are doing, so it wasn't useful for her with the kinds of analysis of what her students were doing.
Yes, for you mentioned sciences mostly at Bryn Mawr College, but for languages, for example, could you do you know what type of tools were used at other colleges?
Mm-hmm. I'm only just now sort of finding out what people are using. I think in many cases, the textbooks that language faculty use often come with grammar exercises and things like this that are online. So there's some of that. And then also a lot of people are using things like VoiceThread, which allows you to, so you put up an object, be it a film or an image or something like this, and students can comment on it, add material to it, but they can do that both spoken orally and by typing. So this is something that a lot of language faculty use, I think, to help students practice. I would say for language faculty, and as you start getting into the humanities, a lot more of the feedback that students are getting might be from other students or from, say, native speakers or something. So you have students connect with people and talk about something, do a project together with other students in the class. A class in that language, maybe that country. Or students, giving each other peer review, peer feedback, that kind of thing.
Is the grant funding over?
Yes. Yes. So we applied. So we had the funding was for 1 year, and then they had us. We could apply for double. They called it double down. And so there were 39 original folks in the grant, and they funded two of the double down proposals, and ours was not one of them. So at the moment we are without funding other than what Bryn Mawr is continuing to fund. And we have applied to the Mellon Foundation specifically for the notion of continuing to support this conference and supporting development of materials for the humanities. So some of the idea that I talked about where there are a lot, people on multiple campuses interested in a particular class and about making materials for it. People have talked about art history, the intro to art history, kind of being something that might be lend itself to this. Applying to Mellon to fund, through Bryn Mawr, but then to include partners in that to be able to do that. So we are trying to find other funding. We've put in an NSF proposal for the science courses. So we're trying, but so far have not landed additional funding on top of that.
Did faculty report any issues with learning differences and the introduction of this kind of assessment? Because I know in my own course, there were a lot of issues with learning differences in accommodations and having online-based assessment.
Yes, and this is something, I don't know that the faculty that I've talked to, this hasn't come up, but I know sort of big picture, this is coming up in a lot of campuses. Commercial companies are really starting to look at this because of, there's a section 50-something, I don't know which one, but it's for if you receive government funding for something, when you put up online materials, they need to be accessible to a wide range of people with all sorts of disabilities. So publishers, I think things that are developed commercially are going in that direction. They've had some halting success. In our case, though, for the sort of in-house stuff, it's been a little harder. We're not necessarily really up on, how to do these things, and so that's something that we need to pursue, I think, local knowledge. Another thing is, for example, figuring out with the tools that we have, like Moodle, how to give one student more time, but not everybody, so those sorts of things. So I think that, yes, that has come up a little bit, and that is something that people are pushing. On the other hand, I would say that I think probably the same issues come up with in-classroom assessment as well, and so it does offer you a different kind of assessment, maybe, and that there are, I don't know. That is an issue. Thanks.
Yeah. I was wondering if anybody's had any, I don't know if you call it experience or fear happening with the idea of what do you own once you have created these materials.
Yes.
I know that it's an issue at larger institutions that are pushing for distance learning materials being developed, and then the university says they own the materials and we don't need you anymore.
With our program, it has been very easy because the grant that we had insisted that anything that we developed be shared openly. So, but yes, outside of that, you know, there is a question. And when you look at some of these products, like, as I said, OWL was originally something developed by UMass Amherst, right? It got commercialized. Apnea products also were often developed by individuals. So yes, when I started doing lecture capture, that was something that faculty asked me, you know, well, who owns this? And I discovered that there's actually not a lot of, we don't really have anything formal about intellectual property of any kind, prints, you know, here on campus. And I think we're getting into a point where some of the things that you guys are creating, if they can be shared broadly, are now of value. God forbid. So that's why this is coming up, right?
Yeah.
So yeah, that is an issue. Another issue that came up that was really interesting, especially at last year's conference, and this is something that here in within Bryn Mawr, we want to look at our IS folks over the summer, is students not necessarily knowing what data was being collected about them, right? Mm-hmm. And being very surprised when they discovered that their instructors could see, like, how often they clicked on something, or, you know, and some were very excited about that and felt, okay, you can see that I'm really working hard, you know, and some were horrified, or at least wanted to know that before, you know, wish they had known that before they had gone through the entire course. So I think that's another area where being more upfront with students about what it is that's being collected, what we can see, what we can't see, that kind of stuff.
But just to be clear, the data we collected for the study, they were very clear that we were collecting.
Yes.
Yes. Yes. But we're talking about the in-class. Like,
right.
You know, kind of,
right.
Yeah.
Right. Just, yes. Yes. And that does pose, I mean, IRB issues are also, you know, difficult when doing these processes.
Did you offer any course release time for your faculty? Like, what gave them the confidence that they could, you know, dive into this and put the extra time into it just to, you know, to experiment?
We did summer stipends for faculty, not course releases. Although we are talking about if we're really developing a full course worth of materials for these, you know, and doing it a little bit more professionally, exploring whether we could do course releases and support it for the faculty of the other institutions that are partnering together. So this would be a small number.
I think support is big, having someone that can help, or this kind of crowdsourcing that we're trying to do so you're not having to reinvent the wheel every single time is also a big factor. And then the course stipends that we provided, some faculty I know use those to get student helpers, and then I also have been doing a lot of that. You know, do you need, I can help train the students to do something like this. So that is actually another thing that I kind of point people to, because sometimes, you know, if you're having to develop quizzes in Moodle or something like that, you probably have paper-based ones. And so a lot of it is the grunt work of getting all of that set up and started and that kind of thing. And there are, I think, other ways rather than you.
Because some of it is really tedious, you know, and it isn't really a good use of faculty time, but it's something that students could, who understand what the, you know, the idea behind it, could do it really easily, and probably a lot faster than training the faculty to have to do it. So I think there are ways to get efficiencies there.
And you have development tools listed somewhere. I mean, obviously Moodle is one that you can use to develop quizzes.
Correct.
But there's, I think on your old Moodle site, you used to have some other, what are some other tools that a faculty member might use to create online quizzes?
I would say people tend to use their learning management system first, if your learning management system has that. And so most, Moodle has it, Blackboard has similar things, I'm sure most do. There is a new, something I just saw not too long ago, TEDx has created something that lets you take, it's called TEDx Learn, I think, TEDx Flip This something. But essentially you take a video and you put it up, and then you can have preparatory material that people look at in addition to that video, and then you have a series of assessment questions that would be related to that video as well. So that's one. There are lots of bright, shiny, like Adobe products that are really custom made for you producing bright, shiny packaged things, learning objects, if you will, very high tech, multimedia, that kind of thing. We've tried to steer clear of that because it's then you have to have the bright, shiny package to be able to edit it, right? So it's not as flexible and it doesn't always play well with your learning management system and things like that.
What about the Google?
OLI is one.
I thought there was a Google one. It was for emails. MOOCs.
Another one is Classroom Salon, and we have a gentleman from Ananda Gunawardenath who was developed that. He's going to talk about that tomorrow. And this is one where it enables you to put up a text online, and then your students comment on the text, but they comment in line. So like on the actual part of the document where they're having issues, they highlight that and say that. And then you can ask them questions and they show you where in the document they find, like you can ask where is the evidence to support this point or whatever, and they can tag them. So there are things like that, I think. There's something really new called Smart Sparrow. That is being set up as a way for you to engineer your own adaptive learning things. Very sophisticated types of things where the students take a, you know, answer a question and the question, depending on how they do, they go to one area or another, that kind of thing. So I was very excited about this. I took a look at it, and it is not something for the faint of heart. It is not something that an individual faculty member, I think, would really want to spend. That this is the issue, the trade-off, right? You want to spend this much time learning how to develop materials, not really.
Now, among all these courses that have been developed, has anyone tried to go public with them rather than just use them at their college?
Not that I know of. Like do a sort of MOOC idea or something, yeah. Not that I know of. And I think maybe some of that is some of these beginning courses, you know, it's really hard to, people always come to me and say, I'm terribly sorry, I only did a tiny bit, you know, I mean, I think you have to develop these slowly over several iterations, so maybe nobody's at that iteration where they're willing to do that, I don't know. Good question. Yeah.
Can you repeat your summary of the experience with lecture capture? I get lost in the detail.
Lecture capture, yes. So we have, this is another thing that we just piloted this year. We did it for specific post-bac courses, actually, initially, because these were students who, you know, they're gonna take their med school entrance exams or whatever, and so they really need to review. But we have a number of faculty who are using it to capture lectures, and what we found is those students are not watching the lectures outside of class, start to finish, right? Unless we have had a few instances in which someone was, you know, hospitalized or something, and this was a way for them to keep up. But for the most part, if you look at the viewing data, students are going to a specific spot, and our system, you know, puts thumbnails in place to help students find those spots where their notes are unclear, or they missed something, or they got confused, and they're looking at that pretty intensely. That's, I think, what I said earlier.
And for the most part, I think it is not affecting class attendance. So we worried that maybe they would just stay home, but they seem to still be. Now, it might be this particular population of students who are highly compliant and eager. But by and large, we have not seen a significant impact on class attendance.
And does it seem to be worth the effort?
Yes, I would say. Well, I would speak for, I'm speaking for faculty here, so I think so. So what I just recorded this, I'm recording this lecture right now, and all I had to do was press this. We've got the camera here, it's recording, everything's fine. When I hit stop, it's gonna upload it to the internet. Where the students, if we were in a course, where the students would have access to it, I would do nothing else. I would never have to look at it again if I didn't want to. I think when it's that easy, it's relatively low cost for faculty, and if students are finding it really valuable, most faculty are willing to do it. So in the cases where this is expanded beyond, actually, and with the courses we started with, it was student demand that had caused this. Where I think it gets really tough and maybe not so useful is when you have to start doing things like editing the video or, you know, taking out the pauses, or if you do that sort of thing, then yeah, the effort goes up substantially.
What about another kind of cost, space on your college's system, and mm-hmm. cost of, I'm not sure of what you had to have in that camera to do what you're doing?
This is actually a webcam.
Okay.
So we initially looked at, like, you know, the full bells and whistles, a tracking camera or something like that, and that was, you know, multiple thousands, tens of thousands of dollars. You can get by with a webcam, and that's what we found with this lecture capture stuff. It's really just a tool that students use to review. Production value does not have to be very high. Now, if we were going to, you know, record courses and maybe put them out for alums to watch or something like that, maybe then you'd want to start thinking about production values. But I think just to produce a tool that students can use to review outside of class, it can be really low-key, low-cost.
Space on your server?
Space on our server. There are a couple of companies now who are actually streaming these, so that's what we went with. So this is all cloud-based. Mm-hmm. Now, we do have limited space on that, but you can pay to get more space, so it's a matter of how much space you're willing to use.
The one limitation we found is the Blackboard, that we've had some have been less successful. It's great for PowerPoint and that kind of thing, but capturing what's happening on the Blackboard has been more challenging.
Like, you can imagine, if I raise this, how big this Blackboard is. So the writing is going to be really tiny, right? Unless you're willing to focus on just a specific area and not go beyond that.
It's still the organic chemistry folks. There's a demand.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah, there's enough of a demand, and the students are willing to put up with, you know.
I just want to be mindful.
Yes. We are at the end of our time, so refreshments break upstairs.
It says 10:15.
Oh, it says 10:15. Oh, okay, we got 10 minutes.
Do we have another question?
Yeah, there is another question. Somewhere in the back.
No, so they have to be dead.
Okay, great.
Now
we have all right, so we'll see you back here at 10:30, is that right?
Yeah, right.